Hello and welcome students. Today we are going to start with our module number 6 of unit number 2, that is reactive power management. We are going to continue. In the previous module, we have already started our reactive power management unit. We have seen what are the significances of the reactive power in the power system network, what are its adverse effects, all the pros and cons of the reactive power. Now we are going to see how we can compensate this reactive power. We are going to see various compensation techniques and brief details of each of the techniques which are used in the real time for the compensation of reactive power. So let's begin our unit. We have completely divided our unit number 2 into 3 modules. The first module was dealing with what is reactive power, necessity and adverse effects of the reactive power, and overview of various methods of controlling the reactive power. Now, today we are going to see our module number 2 that basically deals with the compensation techniques and their details. First, we will see the tap changing transformer. It is not one of the compensation techniques, but it is going to change or vary the voltage profile of a system. So indirectly it is changing the reactive power in the network. So we are going to also see this tap changing transformer, then shunt compensation, series compensation and synchronous condenser. In the upcoming module number 3, we are going to see the reactive power generation by synchronous machine, that is how the synchronous motor is generating, or by varying its power factor or its excitation, how it is going to change the power factor of a network. Then next is the effect of excitation on reactive power magnitude in the power system. Next one is the loading capability curve of a generator. What are the constraints within which your alternator must be operated or your synchronous motor must be operated in order to compensate for the reactive power. So let's move ahead. For this unit number 2, I have basically referred to IJ Nagarath and DP Kothari sir's textbook, that is Modern Power System Analysis. This book is self-sufficient for reactive power compensation. And if you want to go into the details or want to refer some other textbook which are quite like in understanding a few things in details, then you can go through Ashfaq Hussain, that is Electrical Power System.
So before going on to the reactive power management techniques, that is various compensation technique, you need to know few basics of the reactive power, that is why we are using the shunt reactors or why we are using shunt capacitors in order to compensate. So before going on to their techniques, you need to know the basic about that inductor or a capacitor which we are using for compensating. So inductor basically absorbs the lagging reactive power and delivers the leading reactive power. Since when the inductive load is connected, you might have seen that your current is lagging the voltage, that is voltage of the line or voltage of the circuit, and thus it is absorbing actually the lagging reactive power. And suppose if it is absorbing the lagging reactive power, means the source is delivering that lagging reactive power, means the inductor can deliver the leading reactive power. It absorbs the lagging reactive power and it delivers the reverse. The converse of this is it delivers the leading reactive power. Similar is the case that capacitor absorbs the leading reactive power. So you have seen that when a capacitor is connected in a circuit, what happens? Your current leads the voltage. So it means that it absorbs the leading reactive power. And if it is absorbing the leading reactive power, means source is delivering the leading reactive power. And the capacitor conversely is also true, that it is able to deliver the lagging reactive power, right? If it is absorbing the leading reactive power, then it is delivering the lagging reactive power. And in case of inductor, If it is absorbing the lagging reactive power, means it is delivering the leading reactive power. So in the circuit, you might have gone through in power system 1 and power system 2 course when you were when you used to see the regulation of the voltage. So in that, if the voltage regulation is positive, it means that the lagging reactive VAR, that is a reactive power, is in the demand. So who will deliver the lagging reactive power? Obviously the capacitor. So that is why, in order to compensate for this much amount of voltage in the system, we want to connect the capacitor so that it can deliver the lagging reactive power, and thus the voltage will be amplified, or voltage will be compensated, and voltage regulation becomes zero, and thus it improves the power factor. Similarly, if the voltage regulation is negative in the sense it is in the demand of the leading VAR, that is leading reactive power, and who will deliver that leading reactive power? Obviously the inductor. So that is why we connect the inductor, and this inductor will compensate for the voltage regulation. It will make the voltage regulation zero by providing a leading reactive power to the circuit, and thus improves the power factor. So these are very important basic points before using the inductor and capacitor for the compensation techniques of the reactive power.
So the first compensation technique is the tap changing transformer. So you know that a transformer is a device, that is electromagnetic device or a static device, which is used to just regulate the voltage at the terminals, be it a step down voltage or step up voltage. What do we mean? That when we want to increase the voltage level, we basically increase the number of turns, and when we want to decrease the voltage magnitude, we basically decrease the number of turns. So finally, here what happened? We have a transformer which has two windings, primary and secondary winding, and basically primary winding is considered when it is connected to the source, and the secondary winding is the winding which is connected to the load terminals. So any one of the winding can be high voltage winding or a low voltage winding. So here we want to see the details of tap changing transformer. Now what do we mean by taps? Taps is nothing but basically a selector switch which connects any one of the turn with the phase line. Okay, so the number of turns coming in between this line and the tap will be counted as the total number of turns for increasing or decreasing the voltage. So basically here you can see a definition. A tap changer is a device fitted to a power transformer for regulation of the output voltage to required level. Now required level can be anything like your step down or step up. If you want to increase the voltage level or decrease voltage level, any. It does not necessarily mean you want always to step down the voltage or you always want to step up the voltage. As per our requirements, we can do either of the side. Now next is the tap changer alters the turns ratio. Now what is the turns ratio? It is basically the ratio of primary winding to the secondary winding turns, right? We are only changing the number of turns, and thereby we are altering or changing the magnitude of the voltage. And so here altering the number of turns in one winding of the appropriate transformer. So tap changer transformer can be of two types. One is your offload tap changing and second is your onload tap changing. Now what do we mean by offload and onload? We will see. So in an onload tap changing, what happens? There is a tap selector and it will select the appropriate tap. In this diagram, you can watch that this arrow like thing is nothing but a tap selector. Wherever it is short circuited or it is connected, it is touching, then it will connect that that turn to the main phase, right? So this is nothing but the number of turns which are coming in between. Now here also we have a tap changer or a tap selector. You can see wherever it is connecting, then it is connecting that point and short circuiting your total, you are including all the number of turns in between to from phase line to that number of tap. So likewise, if we select, if we move this tap selector to this point, then this these many number of turns will come in between, which is between the line, phase line and this selector. So we are increasing the number of turns. It means we are increasing the voltage level. If we are moving this selector over here, then as compared to the previous point, we are reducing the number of turns, and hence the voltage magnitude is also decreased. So this is how we are using this tap selector for the tap changing transformer. And here we want to know what is on load tap changing. Here on load tap changing is nothing but when the transformer is connected on the either side of the power system network, from the incoming side as well as to the outgoing side of the power system network, and during the live power transfer, we are changing this selector or the tappings, and thus we are changing the voltage magnitude, then such type of operation of a transformer is called as on load changing the magnitude of the voltage, and such transformer is called as on load tap changing transformer. But if there is an interruption of the supply for changing this selector switch, like we are, this type of operation is called as manually changing the position of the selector switch from one point to the another point, that is one tap to the another tap, by first cutting down the supply from incoming side and outgoing side. We are totally isolating the transformer, and then we are changing the selector point to the tappings, and then after like connecting this selector point to one of the tap, and then connecting the incoming and outgoing power system network, then such type of transformer is called as a offload tap changing transformer. Understand? So what is the main difference between these? That in a onload tap changing, there is no interruption of the supply. Even when we are changing the position of the tap, we are not interrupting the power supply from incoming and outgoing side of the transformer. But in case of offload, we are actually interrupting first the supply and then we are changing the taps. So this is the main difference between the onload and offload changing type of transformer. And thus, by changing the number of taps, basically your taps are given on the high voltage side, that where the high turns are there, and by thereby putting the taps on it, we can regulate the amount of turns we want to include, and thus we can regulate the voltage magnitude. So basically your tappings are given on the high voltage winding of the transformer, be it a on load tap changing or off load. On both the transformer, the taps are given on the high voltage winding, right? So I hope you are clear between the differences of off load and on load. So next one is your series compensation technique. A series compensation is nothing but a method of improving the system voltage by connecting a capacitor in series with the transmission line. So what happened in a series compensation? The reactive power is inserted in series with the transmission line, and for improving the impedance of the system. So when the impedance of the system is improved, it improves the power transfer capability of the line. When we say that we improve the impedance of a network, means we are actually decreasing the impedance, and thus we know that power transfer capability is inversely proportional to the power transfer capability. So it improves the power transfer capability of the line, and this type of technique is basically used in a power high voltage, that is extra high voltage transmission line. So here we will see the advantages of series compensation. First one is we will increase the transmission capacity. Just I have explained you that when we put the capacitor in series with the transmission line, we improve this reactance part, Right. Means we are decreasing this reactance part, and when this reactance part is decreased, your power transfer capacity increases since they are inverse proportion to each other. So here your E is nothing but a sending end voltage, your V is the receiving end voltage, and delta is actually the phase angle between the induced voltage and the terminal voltage, right? So this is your first advantage. Here we will also see the detail, that is power transfer with and without the compensation. So when it was without the compensation, your total reactance was XL, and when we compensated the reactance, that is when we have improved the impedance of a network by putting the capacitive reactance in series, so the total, since they are opposite to each other, they will cancel out the magnitude of the impedance in the network. So the total impedance becomes like XL minus XC. So this reactance magnitude will be obviously lesser than this magnitude. So when this becomes lesser, so the power, that is P2, becomes more than the P1. So here, if you want to compare the power transmission capacity compared with the previous one without compensation and with compensation, it is P2 by P1 is equal to XL by XC. Here E and V will get cancelled out since they are common in both the power equation. So remaining is XL by XL minus XC. So when you try to simplify it, it becomes 1 by 1 minus K. Here K is nothing but a degree of compensation, how much, what is the magnitude of capacitor you have connected in series, and according to that you will reduce this reactive power, and thus by that ratio your power transfer capability will increase. So this is how you will compensate for reactive power in a series compensation. And so the range of compensation, that is the economic degree of compensation, will lie between 40 to 70%, and your K value is always less than 1. If it is, the compensation is around 40 to 70%, it means it is 0.4 or 0.7, the value of K. It is always less than 1. It cannot become totally 1, because if it becomes 1, then this will go to this part will become 0, and if this part becomes 0, then obviously the power transfer capability will reach to infinity. So this is nothing but an ideal case, which does not happen in practical cases, right? I hope you understood this advantage. Now next advantage is the improvement in the system stability, that for same amount of the power transfer and the same value of E and V, your delta in case of a series compensated line is less than the uncompensated line. So obviously when the delta value is less, then the sine delta value will be less, and it improves the system stability, that is fluctuation of the delta is less, and thus it improves the system's stability. Here I have again compared with and without compensation. This is without compensation and this is with compensation. So obviously sine delta 2 by sine delta 1, when we try to have a compensation, your this numerator part will cancel out and your denominator remains. So when we take this XL minus XC by XL, so obviously this part is lesser compared to this part. Denominator is more, and thus if this is less, means your sine delta will also be less, that is the fluctuation in the rotor angle will be less, and thus the system stability improves. So here this is what I have concluded in the last point. A lower delta means there is a better system stability. The series compensation offers most economic solution for the system stability as compared to the other methods. It reducing the generator transformer reactance or bundled conductors or increased number of the parallel circuit. That is what just by connecting a capacitor, a high value magnitude capacitor in series with the transmission line, you can easily compensate the impedance and thus improve the power transfer capability. The next advantage of the series compensation is the load division between the parallel circuit. When the system is to be strengthened by the addition of the new line, or when one of the existing line is to be adjusted for the parallel operation. Basically, why we do the parallel operation? In order to share the load, since the increasing demand from the load side, we want to share the load among the generators. So during sharing of the load, obviously the impedances improves and impedances increases, and the losses also increases, that is I square R losses while sharing. So but if we do the compensation, it reduces the losses because it increases the active power transfer capability. So reduces the current and improves the voltage actually. So this is the major benefit of the series compensation. It is also seen that compensation in the 420 kV system was entirely recovered due to decrease in the losses in 220 kV. Right. Next is less installation time for connecting your series capacitor. The time is quite smaller as compared to installation time required for the parallel circuit. If we want to share the load, you will always go to the parallel circuit, and when you are connecting this parallel circuit, obviously it is going to take more installation time. But if you connect the capacitor and then share the load, obviously the installation time is going to be reduced. So this obviously reduces the risk factor. Obviously, when the installation is done during that particular period of time, we need to interrupt the power supply, the reliability loses, and thus there is an interruption of the supply to the loads also. But it doesn't occur in the case of capacitor. Of course, there is an interruption of the supply, but it is not for the larger duration of time. So because installation cost itself is installation time itself is less, so here interruption time will also be less. So obviously risk factor reduces. Hence use to hit the current thermal limit, and the life of the transmission line and capacitor is generally 20 to 25 years compared to the other parallel circuit. So but the certain compensation technique has its own pros and cons. So we have seen how it is giving you the benefits, but we do have cons in this series compensation. Since there is a series, so obviously the fault current increases rapidly in case of sudden short circuits occur over the transmission line. So if you have done any compensation, that is series compensation, then it will definitely going to increase the power transfer capability, but at the same point, if there is a sudden short circuit occurring over the line, then it will increase the short circuit current also. Second is the maloperation in the distance relay if the degree of compensation and the location is not proper. And third is the high recovery voltage of the line across the circuit breaker. So suddenly when you remove the line for the outage purposes and connect after rectifying the faults, then there is a sudden rise in the voltage across the circuit breakers, and which is quite harmful. It might collapse the entire system also. Then the same problems extends to ferro resonance also due to this series compensation. Now we'll look into the details. What do we mean by actually the ferro resonance, then subsynchronous resonance? What are these two phenomena? In linear resonance, the current and voltage are linearly related in a manner that which is frequency dependent. In case of ferro resonance, it is characterized by a sudden jump of the voltage or current from one stable operating point to another one. So the relationship between the voltage and current is dependent not only on the frequency but also on the other factors. These factors can be like a voltage magnitude, initial magnetic flux condition of the transformer iron core, the total loss in the ferroresonant circuit and the point on the wave of initial switching. So these are the reasons for the ferroresonance to occur. So in a ferroresonance, it is a non-linear kind of a resonance where a reactive inductive reactance and capacitive reactance are not equal.
Moving ahead on the topic of subsynchronous resonance, this is also one of the disadvantage of connecting a capacitor in series with the alternator. So basically, what do we mean by ferroresonance is when a series capacitor introduces this series capacitor introduces a subsynchronous frequency. What does this mean is your phenomena, it is when one or more resonant frequencies, like when the turbine is connected with the help of a shaft to a generator, then there is a certain turbine generator frequency and the other frequency is your system's frequency. So these two frequency coincide through the generator with this natural resonant frequency of the electrical system. So whatever the frequency is associated with the electrical power system network is called as a natural resonant frequency, and this frequency interact with the turbine generator's frequency. So this is going to cause a very serious issue. It will cause a sustained and cyclic exchange of energy between the mechanical shaft and the electrical system. And here the system is nothing but any system which provides the opportunity for an exchange of the energy at a given subsynchronous frequency of the system. So this exchange of the energy results in the torsional stresses, right? So these stresses do occur over the turbine generator shaft, and this lead to a severe damage, and this damage can be even a fracture of the shaft connecting the turbine and the generator. This subsynchronous frequency or resonance is a very serious problem, but of course it is not that encountered very frequently. It is very rare phenomena, but it is a very serious and severe phenomena. When these two frequencies interact, that is your turbine shaft generator's frequency and the power system's natural resonating frequency, when these two frequency interacts, they actually cause a stress over the shaft, and the shaft due to these frequency may get damage, may get fracture, and it will lose, sometimes it will break down, and thus your mechanical and electrical system get isolated from each other. So this is what happens. But in case of a hydro turbine generators, here I have mentioned a point that in case of a hydro turbine generator, this risk of subsynchronous resonance is very less, since your shaft turbine is huge, has got large inertia constant, and the frequency, thus the stress is lower. That is having a frequency of about only 10 hertz or even lesser than that. So this phenomena is not dominant in case of a hydro turbine generator, but in case of a thermal, it is dominant, though it is not encountered frequently. So I hope you are clear with the subsynchronous resonance, which is the biggest disadvantage of connecting series capacitor in series with your alternator. So coming to your shunt compensation technique, shunt compensation is basically for the normal operating voltages line. For high voltage transmission line, your capacitance, that is line capacitance from ground to the live conductor, is developed, and it is very high, and this plays a very significant role in the voltage conditions at the receiving end, right? So when the line is loaded, then the reactive power demand of the load is partially made by the reactive power generated by the line capacitance, and the remaining reactive power is made by the reactive power flowing from sending end to receiving end. So when the capacitances are connected or it is developed, so partial reactive power is met by the capacitance, and partially it is been flowing from sending end to receiving end. So when the load is high, that is more than the surge impedance loading, then the larger reactive power flows from sending end to the receiving end, and it when the larger reactive power flows means there is a huge current flowing more than the rated in the line and causes I square R losses and thermal losses. It causes a large voltage drop in the line. Thus, to improve the voltage at the receiving end, because the drops have occurred between the sending end and receiving end, so now the receiving end voltage is lesser than the required. So in order to improve that, the shunt capacitors are connected at the receiving end to generate and feed the reactive power. Which reactive power? Lagging reactive power to the system, that is to the load, so that the reactive power flow through the line and the voltage drop will reduce. Understood. So next is to control the receiving end voltage. A bank of capacitor is installed at the receiving end. Like I have previously mentioned, why we are connecting is because capacitor has a property of delivering the lagging reactive power, and hence reactive power rather taking from the supply, that is rather flowing from the receiving end to the sending end, the load's reactive power fulfillment is done with the help of these capacitors. The large number of capacitors are connected in parallel near the receiving end, and these suitable number of capacitors are switched in during the high load condition, and thus can be varied depending upon the load demand. So here, if your XC is equal to 1 by omega C, that is your reactive capacitive reactance is termed like this, is a shunt capacitor reactance, then the reactive power generated of a leading wire, of a leading wire supplied by the capacitor is given by V2 square by XC, which is nothing but XC can be termed as omega C. So your reactive power, your leading reactive power is nothing but square times of the voltage into omega C. So it is hence directly proportional to square times of the voltage. But when the we have till now discussed how we can compensate if the load is more than the surge impedance loading. But if the load is less than the surge impedance loading, then the reactive power generated by the line capacitor, it is nothing but the reactive power demand in this case is lesser than the reactive power generated by the line capacitor. So under this condition, the reactive power flow through the line becomes negative, obviously. And thus the reactive power flowing from the receiving end to the sending end, and the receiving end voltage becomes higher than the sending end. So power flow is reversed due to the demand is reduced, and thus the receiving end voltage become more than this, and such phenomena is called as Ferranti effect. To control the voltage at the receiving end, what we do is we try to sink down the reactive power, and this will be achieved only by connecting the shunt reactors at the receiving end. So when the reactive power demand was more than the surge impedance loading, we connected a shunt capacitors at the receiving end, and when the reactive power demand is less than the surge impedance loading, we have connected shunt reactors at the receiving end. So in this case, what happened, if XL is given as, that is inductive reactance is given as omega L, then what is the VAR absorbed here is QL is equal to square times of the voltage by XL. This can also be written as V2 square by omega L. Here also your reactive power is proportional to square times of this and inversely proportional to the inductive reactance. So controlling the receiving end voltage, generally one shunt reactor is installed and switched in during the light loading conditions, because during the light loading conditions the drops are less and there are chances that your receiving end voltage is more than the sending end voltage. To meet this variable, like whenever the load fluctuates, we need to regulate or we need to vary the reactive power demands. So this can be done by the number of shunt capacitors which are switched in or switched out as per our requirement. Likewise, we can have the combination of shunt capacitors and shunt reactors together at a time, and they can be switched in to the circuit or switched out of the circuit as per the reactive power demand, as per the absorption of the reactive power. In this way we can adjust the reactive power of the circuit. So next topic is your synchronous condenser.
So a synchronous condenser is basically a overexcited synchronous motor which is lightly loaded or at the no load condition. So when it is at the no load condition, it can generate or absorb the reactive volt ampere by varying the excitation of its field winding. Okay, so when we vary its excitation of the field winding, the field current varies, and when the field current varies, we can either inject the current or we can reject this current from the circuit. So thus, by injecting the current in the circuit through the field excitation, or by varying the magnitude of this field current, we can vary the power factor of the circuit. Here you can also consider that it is just like a active shunt compensation technique. It is used for improving the voltage profile and the system's stability. Here in the alternator topic, you might have gone through the V curves and inverted V curves. In the V curves, it is actually a plot between the armature current and the field current, that is the excitation current. So when you keep on increasing the excitation current, your power factor vary from lagging point till the leading point, synchronous condenser, which takes up the leading current or the lagging current depending upon its excitation. But putting this synchronous condenser into practice is a bit uneconomical, because it requires maintenance now and then, and it also costlier compared to the other shunt compensation technique or the series compensation technique. But it is obviously the most efficient compensation technique of the reactive power. So with this last compensation technique, that is synchronous condenser, we come to the end of this various compensation techniques of reactive power. Further, we will continue in the module number 3 about the alternator, that how the loading capability curves are plotted and what is the significance of the loading capability curve of the alternator. So thank you so much.